Hi, Mark.
Hey, Bob.
How you doing?
I'm doing okay.
Good. Let me introduce this. I'm Robert Wright. This is the Wright Show on meaningoflife.tv, and you are Mark Van Steenwyk. You are a Christian anarchist. Am I right about that?
Yeah. I mean, I don't necessarily wear that label as a badge because it just evokes confusion.
We'll try to clear up the confusion. We'll try to make that a badge you can wear unambiguously. By the end of our conversation, you will have ordered the badges so that you can wear them. So
Nice.
clear will it
Yes.
be what a Christian anarchist is.
Indeed.
Okay, so now you are the author of that Holy Anarchist, Reflections on Christianity and Anarchism, which is available at Amazon.com. I think it's also downloadable somewhere on the web, and people needn't feel guilty about copyright infringement if they download it, because on the title page, where most books say who holds the copyright, this book says this book is not copyrighted, which I take it is in some sense a reflection of anarchist values, or am I reading too much into that?
No, it's definitely at least a reflection of my anarchist values. So if you just Google that holy anarchist, there's a I think it's like that holyanarchist.com. You can download it and you can print it out. You could bind it and give it all to your friends, and there's no copyright whatsoever.
Okay, so I want to talk about what that means. But first, I think people who are, now some people are just listening to this as a podcast, but some people are viewing it, and the viewers may be curious about your t-shirt. So, and let me describe it for podcast listeners. It's got a guy in a gas mask, wearing a gas mask and playing guitar. In the background are what seem to be ruins. This has a slightly apocalyptic or post-apocalyptic vibe. How do you interpret your t-shirt, Mark?
To be honest, I just threw it on this morning because I was wearing it yesterday. But I can't remember his first name, Drucker, last name Drucker. He's an artist who does a lot of anarchistic stuff. And this is actually a t-shirt from one of my publishers, PM Press, which publishes a lot of leftist anarchist stuff. And to me, all his stuff shows some sort of grim hopefulness in the midst of civilizational catastrophe. So there's a little bit of this new world in the shell of the old kind of thing.
I'm
And
with
even
you.
maybe a defiance in the face of empire.
I'm with you on that general sense of things,
Yeah.
with the possible exception of the hopefulness. No, I'm modestly hopeful.
Well, I on a good day I'm hopeful in a real way, and on bad days I feel like my hope is sort of a kind of a fictitious defiance. But either way, I feel
Yeah.
like it's they have some hope.
Before we get into exactly what anarchism means and what Christian anarchism means, what are your main sources of despair these days? What is it about the world that's got you most down?
To me, this is kind of right at the intersection of why I'm interested in faith. And like the politics of anarchism is to me the thing that despairs me the most is when I see people who maybe I think of them as being asleep, who just don't see the problems of the world and they think everything's okay, or at least, oh, it could be worse, so I'm not going to care. That sentiment, that sort of manufactured apathy, causes me the most despair. And the way it plays out is the way that people seem so nonchalant about everything from drone warfare to the economic exploitation happening all around us. But recently, I feel like the attitudes about immigration are getting me the most bummed out. My wife teaches refugees, and so just the and they're mostly Muslim refugees. So that sort of anti-immigrants kind of mentality, plus the Islamophobia, that kind of cocktail. Kind of makes me mad more than
Yeah.
most other things these days.
And I should say that although we will not post this immediately, we are taping it on the day after the Super Bowl. And I don't know if you're a big football fan, but the New England Patriots had come to be associated with Donald Trump Yeah. Partly because the owner, coach, and quarterback are friends of his. And they staged a comeback that was eerily reminiscent of the election that bummed a lot of people out. I got to say, I actually had a dream about the apocalypse last night. I'm not sure it's related, but I did. Anyway,
I think it's an apt dream.
It felt apt. Yeah. So let's talk about anarchism then. First of all, you know, I think a lot of people, they hear anarchist, they would think running through the streets, smashing windows. I don't think that's exactly what you have in mind. Maybe. What is anarchism, PU?
Well, I think that's still in the umbrella.
You're not averse to that.
Well, when I get upset, I'm not someone who goes around smashing windows, and I'm not morally opposed or ethically opposed to property destruction. I just usually, if I'm going to smash something, I want it to really be, really to count. So I'm not into kind of wanton destruction. That sort of tactic, that's not really, to me at least, the core of anarchism, and usually anarchists that do that sort of stuff aren't people that, I don't want to like just dismiss that, because to me there are worse things to be dismissive about. But for me, anarchism is simply the recognition that any form of structural or systemic hierarchy where some people have power over another in any area, whether it's husbands over wives, or the government over its people, or the rich over the poor, whites over black, any of that sort of structural hierarchy is bad, and we should get rid of it. But to me, that's the essence of anarchism. And of course, then you get some analysis over how you understand those different hierarchies and what things constitute hierarchy. Mm-hmm. Then it gets a little dicier, but that's, to me, that's the core.
Okay. And at this point, maybe we should say a couple of things that we will follow up on either now or later. One is that you are a Mennonite, right? And Mennonites are historically, at least some Mennonites, some substantial number of Mennonites are historically associated with anti-war activities and with, I guess, small-scale communal living, right? And you are now engaged in a version of that. You founded what's called an intentional community, which is, does that mean more or less small communal living of the devoted to certain values that tend to be left wing? Is that what an intentional community is?
Generally, I mean, there are right wing intentional communities, I'm sure, but yeah, it's usually people committed to a common cause living together. So it's kind of like the new version. We don't use the word commune anymore.
Good branding decision.
Yeah. Because, you know, I mean, I'm sure there are intentional communities where there are orgies and drugs, but fortunately or unfortunately, depending on how you look at it, ours is not one of those. Ours is pretty mellow.
I'm sorry to hear that. So yours is, where are you? Are you in Pennsylvania or something? Where are you?
We're in Minneapolis.
That's right. Are you from the Twin Cities?
I grew up in rural Minnesota, and I'm actually not a Mennonite by background. I'm one of these people that I used to be all fundamentalist, and I shifted. So to me, I needed to find a new people where I didn't feel quite as theologically insane.
Okay.
Yeah.
And there's an interesting story about how you became a Christian in the first place that I'd like you to tell. This is your mystical experience?
Oh, the Bible camp mystical experience?
Yeah. Okay. So you were, how old were you?
14.
And how had you come to be at a Bible camp if you weren't really a Christian to begin with, or were you in some sense?
I was the generic sort of, like the way in which most rural Minnesotans would probably think of themselves as Christians, I guess I was.
Were you brought up Lutheran or something?
No. My dad was a backslidden Mormon.
Uh-oh.
So it filtered in. But I wasn't particularly...
He was a Mormon of Dutch ancestry?
Yeah, he had some experiences in the Navy that caused him to search for... So he ended up becoming a Mormon.
Okay. So you're a generic kind of Christian, and so you wind up at a Bible study camp, and then what happens at age 14?
So I'm 14 at this fundamentalist Bible camp, which I still have a love for this place. It's where I met my wife, but this, you know, and I was mostly there for girls. That's why most teenagers go to Bible
we're
camp.
We're 14.
Yeah.
But now you're older and wiser, and you would be in it for women instead if you went now, right? You've matured.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, you got to upgrade.
Right.
I was at this camp, and we were having the campfire thing, and you know, the idea is people are supposed to give their testimony about how God has changed their life, and then they throw this stick into the fire out of some sort of ceremonially lifting it to God, and so I think it's supposed to get you in the mood for feeling all repentant and repenting and accepting Jesus. But when this was happening, all of a sudden I had this deep mystical, overwhelming, the sense that, you know, there was pain in the world and suffering in the world, and that I felt in my body that I was the pain and the suffering of the world.
So they had been going around sharing their stories of pain. Is that the idea?
Of the really high school sort. So it's like pain around breakups. Maybe one kid talked about the death of a loved one, but mostly it was I've broken up or I'm struggling at school, which is very real when you're that age. But it was that level of stuff, or pets died. So it was intense pain, but it wasn't exactly like war, Holocaust pain. But in that moment, I connected with that pain, and then I felt a connection to all this stuff. Like I had these things in my mind of like war and death, and it was just, I was overwhelmed with the suffering of the world. And so I started weeping, and I didn't know what to do with it. Of course, my camp counselor came and interpreted it as me feeling weighed down with my own sin, and so he led me in the sinner's prayer of accepting Jesus. But I always look back on that and thinking that I don't regret accepting Jesus into my heart or whatever happened, whatever kind of ritual I went through. But to me, there was something deeper that I still associate with Jesus. But I mean, it could have, I mean, structurally, it probably fits more like a Buddhist sort of conversion experience than.
You know, it's funny because when I read you describing it in an interview, it reminded me of something that I had actually heard a Buddhist talk about. It's actually Vincent Horn, who used to run the Buddhist Geeks podcast, talk about in a TED talk. As I recall his experience, it was very much, I don't think it was stimulated by people recounting their sorrows, but he felt identified. As I recall, I may have it wrong, but with all the sorrow and suffering in the world, so you're contrary to what your like camp counselor might have thought, it wasn't guilt. It wasn't guilt about your own sinfulness. It was closer to being empathy, the universal.
Yeah, empathy. There was a connection that I did feel. There was some sense that I was a part of it, and that maybe I contributed. So that I had a sense of my own complicity. But even that still, I had no way of interpreting it at the time, but that's not a very evangelical way of thinking about sin at all. It was, if anything, it was more of the progressive idea of like maybe understanding privileges and things like that. So it was definitely this experience that was out of place. You know, I feel like I've been, my whole life in some level has been unpacking that experience.
Uh-huh. So when you say it wasn't evangelical, is the evangelical version of it very much about guilt, pure and simple?
Yeah, like I, you know, 14-year-old at camp, you know, you're feeling guilty about masturbating and lusting and cheating in tests, and or maybe, you know, you beat up a kid. Like that kind of very personal, internalized, individualistic sorts of transgressions.
This was more a sense of the tragedy of it all, or...
Yeah, something a little bit deeper than that.
Okay. Which, like,
I think it would be great. I mean, if this is how, if my experience was how Christians generally thought about their own sinfulness, then maybe Christianity would have more to offer.
Mm-hmm. So then you, well, I was going to, well, why don't you take us a little more through the past? So you wind up at that moment, I guess you have accepted Jesus as your Savior, but in a kind of a evangelical context. And then where do you go from there?
I started going to this church that it's one of the kids at the church who invited me to this Bible camp. So this rural evangelical church. And then, you know, they gave me a Bible and told me to start taking it seriously, and I did. On my own, I started interpreting it probably the way someone who isn't, I mean, I was an avid reader, so I'd read like Lord of the Rings and stuff. So when you, someone who has some sophistication in how they interpret texts reads the Bible, especially the Gospels, you kind of take Jesus's moral statements fairly straightforwardly, and maybe some of the apocalyptic stuff in the book of Revelation a little bit more symbolically. And so that's what I did. And so I started kind of like thinking, violence is bad, having wealth is bad, this sort of thing. But immediately I found out that I was reading the Bible entirely wrong. And so I got into, early on as a new Christian, you know, conservative place, got in trouble for having a very radical reading of Scripture. And so this led to two things. One, I got rebuked a lot. But then because my church was also in the charismatic movement, at a certain point I had deliverance done on me, which is where the influence or the possession of demons or evil spirits are cast out of you. Because
that is serious. Like, what denomination was that?
This is a non-denominational. Well, this church was part of the Evangelical Free Church, but it wasn't an Evangelical Free Church, really. It was one of these small rural charismatic churches that was part of a larger charismatic movement that's non-denominational. So there's that. It was the 90s. Late 80s, early 90s, you had a lot of Neil T. Anderson, a lot of deliverance stuff, and casting out demons and breaking demonic oppressions was kind of a vogue.
Is the way they knew you had demons that needed to be cast out that you were taking Jesus literally on some of these points about, like when Jesus said a rich man has the chance of going to heaven that a camel has of passing through the eye of a needle, you thought Jesus meant that a rich man has this chance of going to heaven that a camel has of passing through the eye of a needle?
Yes. Two of the things that, and there were other things, like, so, I mean, the things I had to have cast on me, the spirit of poverty, because I had this, believed in what they called a poverty doctrine, which was what you just described, a spirit of rebellion. I got in trouble for rebuking one of our youth leaders for having a Corvette.
Because that was too showy and...
Yeah, you know, and it's not like I was really loving and compassionate about it. I was being fundamentalistic about my reading of Scripture, but it was still at least probably a better, more accurate read at the time. But also things like, you know, I had to confess that I had played with a Ouija board when I was younger, or I had some comic books that were a little more demon-y, like Spawn comic books, and so all that stuff. So, okay. You know, you do the burning barrel of, like, comic books and secular music, all that kind of stuff. So I had to break the stronghold of Satan and all that so I could be freed up to be useful to the Holy Spirit.
Did you actually feel that it had worked for a while? That the, I mean, you bought into the exorcism idea.
Well, how would I not think that they knew better than me? I mean, I'm a teenage kid, strong-willed, but like they must know it, and I threw myself into that. Mm. I wanted to, if that was Christianity, which I had to assume it was, then I had to throw myself into it and be really good at it.
Okay. So then how'd you wind up a Mennonite?
At a certain time of play, I started having too many questions. Part of it is like I think, I was just always a little too intellectual for my own good. My mother died when I was 19. I had questions about that theologically. But then the big kicker was 9/11. Even as a conservative, I was always this old school, Pat Buchanan style conservative, which isn't great. But one of the good things about it is there's this tendency towards isolationism, where war is seen as this, you don't want to do that. It's the last resort. It's grim. So even though, so there is this old strand of conservatism that sees war.
Well, Trump as the candidate was embracing that kind of conservatism, although it seems to already be turning out he was just kidding. But he picked up on that strand of Buchananite conservatism a lot when he talked about foreign policy during the campaign. So
sure. So I bought into that, and so the 9/11 happens, and because I'm trying to be a true believer about it, and all of a sudden I see people getting excited about war. But like joyful about it. Like people were excited about the idea of this cosmic battle with Islam And there was such delight in it that it really jarred me. And so I kind of went back to reading the Gospels. I started thinking for some solace, and I literally, it was like one day I look up from the Gospel of Luke and thought, shit, I'm a pacifist. And the problem was I was considering, I wanted to go into seminary, and I didn't know how to pay for it at the time, and so I was going to become a chaplain. And so I realized I can't be a chaplain now, not in good conscience. And so
military
chaplain in the Air Force. And so once you start pulling that strand, I'm like, oh, what else am I? And then basically, you know, if you take Jesus seriously about pacifistic things, then the stuff he says about wealth and power, it started unraveling quick. I embraced it and quickly found myself not fitting in very well within my kind of evangelical world. And so that's when I reached out to the Mennonites.
Okay. And so you're about how old now at this point?
Probably 23, 24, somewhere in there.
Okay. And the Mennonites, I mean, again, they have a long pacifist tradition, although I'm sure there are different strands of Mennonitism, as there tend to be, but there's a long anti-war tradition. I think they even opposed the Revolutionary War, didn't they? I mean,
some did, yeah.
And they were also, I think, early on, write the first written protest against slavery or something? I mean, they're left-wing going way back.
Yeah, them and the Quakers.
And the Quakers, with whom, you know, some people might get the two mixed up. I mean, they do have an intertwined kind of ancestry, do they? Or not?
Well, Quakers come from England, and the Mennonites generally come from the Germanic countries. But I mean, when you get to the United States, the first Mennonites come over by being given land grants by the Quakers in Pennsylvania.
Okay.
So there is, in the United States especially, there is this strong commingling. I think the Quakers have had a better track record with some of this stuff, but the difference, one of the big differences between Quakers and Mennonites is Mennonites still have some of the sacraments like baptism and communion, and then even adds like foot washing. Quakers don't have sacraments, and I was still a sacrament kind of guy. So to me, it's like, I'm going to become a Mennonite rather than a Quaker. That's pretty much straightforward. For me.
So a Mennonite service would seem more like a conventional Christian service. I mean, a Quaker service is just people come in and sit down and they remain silent unless one of them feels moved by the Holy Spirit to speak, and then somebody will stand up and speak. But
that's a traditional unprogrammed service. And there are some modern programmed ones where you have a sermon and some of that, but still they tend to avoid having clergy and tend to avoid having any sacraments at all.
Okay. So now, are you a pacifist?
I'd be a pacifist with a little asterisk, maybe, because I feel like one, I want to recognize that destruction of property I don't think of as violence, and I don't even think of tackling someone as violence. So like, there's certain situations where I think some pure pacifist would not think I'm as pure, and then I'm also the sort of pacifist since. There's some complexity with my relative power in the world as a white man, cisgendered, heterosexual white man living in the United States of America, where I have to reserve being able to judge resistance movements. Like, if the Zapatistas and the Chiapas use violence to resist, maybe I wouldn't do that in their place, but I feel like a level of discomfort with condemning that. Mm-hmm. So I don't feel like my pacifism requires that I have a universal like disdain towards any group that uses violence for resistance.
And what are examples of destruction of property that you think are warranted?
You know, so with Standing Rock right now, if people in this resistance for clean water wanted to monkey wrench some equipment that makes it harder for them to just delay these tactics of delaying, things like that to me seem pretty straightforward. Or when in some of the plowshare actions against nukes, if someone wants to dismantle some sort of pour goat blood on a nuclear warhead or monkey wrench or break a drone. That's going to, like, to me, if it's drones or bomb stuff, like, that stuff shouldn't exist. So if someone wants to destroy that, amen. Like, to me, that's good.
Okay.
Things like that are now, really straightforward.
Now, some people, if they say, I'm a pacifist with an asterisk, the asterisk would be, but I would have fought Hitler, or but I would have, you know, what it stepped in if it required violence to head off the Rwandan genocide or so on. But you're not, you don't have those kinds of asterisks. You're a pure.
Well, I mean, those, you know, to me, that's so speculative. Like, I mean, if I had a time machine, maybe I would add that asterisk. But right now, at the resistance I see happening around me, I'm not seeing how me physically hurting anyone will actually improve the situation. So, and I feel like that's the line I want to draw.
Okay. So you, at one point, before you did the intentional community thing, you actually founded a church, right?
Yeah, the church morphed into an intentional community. And that's when I started this church, and I realized that I just kind of hated it. And so, we were going to quit, but we ended up, I just happened to be doing hospitality. My wife, being an English teacher to refugees, we had started practicing hospitality to a student and other people. It seemed like the Christian thing to do. And I realized that was still a life-giving thing, this sort of hospitality in the house. And so we basically shut down doing church and recentered around this communal stuff.
Okay. Yeah. Well, what had the church been called?
We started as a church called Missio Dei, which is Latin for the mission of God.
Mm-hmm. And the church was working out fine, I take it.
Yeah, it was okay. It could have, if I had my heart would have been in it, it would have succeeded as a church, an urban church.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so how is the intentional community thing going?
It was going good for a while, and then I you know, this happens a lot in Catholic or hospitality-centered kind of intentional communities. Burnout and things like that. I'm still sitting in the middle of, in the downstairs level of our intentional community house, but we used to have three community houses and a lot of people, but my inability to have good boundaries with guests, meaning like we took in more people than we could pay for, and so we were always having financial crises. And I hit some burnout from being a little too heroic about it. But now things are fine. But that's a real danger in these intentional communities of there's always this utopian strand of trying too hard to be ideal. And then community is difficult because it's not like we were all friends with good boundaries beforehand. You have to figure that stuff out on the fly.
So how does that, what is, so you said what, hospitality-based or centered? In other words, the idea is that if people need a place to live, you take them in. That's your mission. I mean, I can see how that could lead to some complexity.
Oh, yeah. And so that's the standard Catholic worker practice. And so our community is called the Mennonite worker. And so that worker bit is kind of reflecting on this, you know, ever since Dorothy Day and Peter Morin started the Catholic worker movement, they'd have people like just finding any old spot on the floor if they had space. And so they were going above and beyond about it. So that's always been the tension, is can we get more people in? How can we feed more people? And the thing with Catholic workers is if you're one of the workers, you're living in the houses out of which you serve usually. So there's no like punching out at the end of the day.
So
I mean, you're always on.
So basically you wind up with a lot of homeless people staying with you?
Yeah, and then there's this middle area. People that come for idealistic reasons, and maybe, you know, on the left you have this people that maybe don't have conventional views of employment, or they're barely eking by, and they're supposed to help kind of pay for all this because they're joining in as a worker. But sometimes the line between guest and host gets so blurry that so it all starts to get confusing.
So you've got people who are there because they don't have any money, and you've got people there who are so there because they're so idealistic that they don't have any money.
Yeah.
And your job is to feed all of these people.
Yeah, keep it going. And then I was increasingly becoming someone who didn't have any money.
Uh-huh. We add all that up, and I just don't see you getting, like, you know, seed capital from Silicon Valley or anything. I'm not seeing a great business model here. So you scaled back. You had to scale back in the.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to over this time raise enough funds to have one of the houses paid for, which is the one I'm sitting in, Simone Bay House here. And so we're smaller and we do less heroic hospitality. We have a guest right now, but we usually only have one guest at a time, and it's not like open-ended hospitality. There's got to be some clear parameters on it. And then we mostly use the lower level of our space for a nonprofit that we've launched in the last few months. And that's more the emphasis of, in particular, my work.
So in this kind of house, you host one homeless person at a time, and the other people are kind of there. They're part of the serving the cause. They're the idealists.
And we do our regular things like house meetings and prayers and have meals and things like that.
And what does the nonprofit do?
The nonprofit is the Center for Prophetic Imagination. And to me, the nonprofit is largely educational. So to me, when you start thinking about the sweet spot of prophetic ministry, as you see it through the Hebrew scriptures or in Jesus' time, or, you know, when you think of Dr. King or prophetic movements in our society, you have the strong activistic calling out injustice piece. There is this other piece that's kind of a contemplative or spiritual piece grounded in some sort of hope beyond which you can see. And to me, there's always a creative piece or something artistic. And so we create initiatives that live in that sweet spot, activistic, educational, arts and spiritual kind of programming that helps people see the world more accurately, I'd like to think, and how they can then act in that world with more clarity.
So the projects the nonprofit does happen there where you are, or are they sometimes happening at other places?
Sometimes other places, but we do our officing and a lot of our meetings out of this space. So one example is we do a quarterly worship arts service. It's not a church service. It's a little more creative and open to people, and it's generally kind of organized within by different folks who would identify as queer. So it's a way of trying to explore God and spirituality from a queer trans perspective. And so we call that the turning, and then that happens thematically, and it always has this sort of strong performance art piece to it. And so we do that somewhere else because the space isn't big enough.
I see. So you do it at like a school.
Some rented space, or we do retreats, and usually sometimes I'm doing a series of retreats, and some of them will happen out in the wilderness somewhere, or we'll rent a retreat center or something like that.
And will people come to them who aren't like living there now?
Yep.
And so
that's part of the shift that happened. I think for me, instead of seeing in that old school idea of discipleship where you have someone, people come in to learn more about the way of Jesus, I assumed that they'd have to live with us for that to happen, but that was not a viable model. So now we're just thinking of how can I spread some of this radical Jesusiness without having to live with a bunch of people all the time.
And how do you recruit people for the retreats? Where do these people come from?
Just over the years, I've made connections around the country, and a lot of it's social media connections. So I just put out the word that we're doing some stuff, and people generally show up.
So this has something in common with a Bible camp you attended as a 14-year-old, but with a somewhat different philosophy.
Yeah, I can see there's some overlap. Kind of a calling out of the regular life into, I guess the word would be liminal space, to think about things differently and then reengage the world.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. So this anarchism thing, I mean, the idea is, first of all, that this is viable. I mean, is a long-term vision that, like, there would be no governments as we know them? There could just be a bunch of very small communities that have peaceful relations with one another, and there would be no kind of large-scale authority structures?
Yeah, generally. I mean, the way it looks, I guess, could be different. So if you look at, we generally don't tend to look at church structures as governments, but if you look at the Quakers, this is, to me, they're the most anarchistic among large organizational structures. So they have these they even call them business meetings, where, you know, you sit in silence and you speak into things, and there's usually consensus. And so but what happens when Quakers need to have national level stuff? Well, they send their clerks and representatives to a gathering that does the same thing. And so it's still largely flat. It's still largely consensus based. And there's some representation, but it's definitely not government as we know it. I think that kind of an approach could work if we at least move more towards that. We certainly don't have anything like that now. Mm-hmm. And that's part of the problem.
And do you sense any momentum building for anarchism? I mean, the Occupy Wall Street movement had been identified by some with anarchism and had been criticized. I mean, some had said that that's why it didn't really persist in robust form, was because they wouldn't like get pragmatic and managerial and clarify the goals and so on. Yeah. But
maybe, you know, there might be something to that. I feel like I don't think that anarchism means that you can't have clarity of goals. And so to me, I would agree that Occupy lacked clarity of goals, but I don't think that was the problem of anarchism. I think that was more of a problem of lack of good discernment practices and, you know, lack of leadership. I don't think anarchism is against leadership. So, like, Black Lives Matter is a great example. Like, they're not an anarchist organization, but they function along largely the similar structural lines. Like, it's a leader-full movement, not a leaderless movement. And so if there would have been more of an organizational kind of focus and clarity of goals like Black Lives Matter had, then Occupy could have done just well and still been functionally anarchistic. Mm-hmm. And I think this is the gift of things like Occupy. It did prepare people for being able to be more able to engage in things like Standing Rock and Black Lives Matter. It was almost like a training ground.
Okay. So, and do you see, like, anarchism proper as a movement? Do you see that gaining any steam?
A little bit. To me, I look at leftist kind of movements as sort of interlocking things, and I see the anarchist movement having influence on some of these other movements that I've just mentioned. But within anarchism itself, I see it growing. Republican presidents are good business for anarchists, unfortunately. Everyone starts feeling like an anarchist all of a sudden when Trump gets in office. So, for example, like when Obama was president, I hardly had anyone interested in talking to me about anarchism. And in fact, I had started shifting some of my rhetoric to not talk about anarchism and talk about some of the principles without naming it as such. But just the day after, I started having people like ask me, can you tell me more about anarchism? Because people just all of a sudden wanted to start smashing the state suddenly. So I see there's some momentum for it, but I feel like maybe it won't fall under the language of anarchism. Maybe it's just a broader movement among the radical left, anti-authoritarian left. Whatever it's called, it doesn't matter. As long as there's more of a movement towards real democracy, more towards economics that's more socialistic and still anti-authoritarian, I see a lot of energy towards that. And that's what I basically see anarchism as, so that's fine if it's not called that.
And what about specifically Christian energy of this sort? Are you seeing, whether under the label anarchism or not, are you seeing more of that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, especially, I think there's a bigger movement just out of Christianity altogether. But among Christians who still feel like a love towards this ideal of Jesus, and as they get sharper clarity about what that means, and then look around and see the ways in which the church as it is failed to live according to that, I think there's a lot of movement towards something more along an anarchistic reading of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And I see that happening more and more all the time. And then the question is, how do you organize that? Mm-hmm. That's a hard question, because the way that the way Christianity is traditionally organized is around churches. But that's not... People are less likely to want to be in churches, but are still wanting to explore what Christian anarchism is. And so oftentimes a lot of people just move away from their faith and hold kind of a private faith in Christ, but then they engage in leftist politics. And so part of what my work now is trying to bring back some of the mystical and spiritual practices into the sort of the anarchist or activist work. Because to me, personally, I have the personal view that if you're not engaged in contemplative practice and something that's spiritually of life-giving, you're going to just burn out and lack a big picture in your activism. Mm-hmm.
And do you sense that many of the people you're describing who've kind of moved away from the church but maintain their faith are creating things at all like what you've got? In other words, something that is centered in basically a home. I mean, is not doesn't have a big edifice associated with it or anything, but would be reminiscent of, you know, early, you know, St. Paul's kind of like meanderings, right, where people would meet in people's homes and so on. Are you seeing that kind of thing?
Well, that's the question. I think during the Bush administration, you saw a huge growth in that. And that started winding down with Obama, partly because of there's less of that motivating energy under Obama, but also because the economy tanked, you know, in 2008. So it was not as financially viable to try to get houses or even rent houses. But now that Trump's in office, you know, I kind of expect there to be an uptick in some of these experiments again. Mm-hmm. But we'll see. It's kind of hard. This is hard days to predict right now. Things, I feel like the manual on how things are supposed to go is out the window. So maybe it'll be home-based. I imagine there's more people that are familiar enough with organizing for there to be a growth of a new number of collectives that maybe aren't home-based but are planning direct actions together. I see that on the uptick. And within Christian traditions like the Catholic worker movement, there's this old tradition of doing these prophetic liturgical acts where you do a kind of a ritual march to some sort of bank, and then you knock over stuff like Jesus knocked over the money changers. I see a lot more of that stuff probably happening. I can't imagine that not happening more and more as people with their Christianity to this political climate.
Okay. And, you know, some people take Jesus as inspirational, but sheerly as an ethical leader, right? And don't buy into any of the theology, whatever. I mean, do you have a position on that or care whether people who affiliate with your particular movement accept the theology or not, or what?
I mean, personally, I'm more interested in, at least on the front end, people start identifying with the ethics. And then I want to encourage them, even if they don't believe Jesus is God or any of that stuff, I want to encourage people more and more to at least take the posture Jesus did. So even if you can't acknowledge Jesus as some sort of third member of the Trinity, at least trying to incorporate the practices and the way that Jesus tried to have a really mystical view of the universe and had a relationship with God, however you define God, if I can get people to at least be in that same sort of posture of being linking action with contemplation, I think that's good enough, at least for the purposes of working together on some common things. Personally, I mean, I'm fairly orthodox when it comes to my theology in terms of worshiping Jesus as the manifestation of God, but I'm not going to be strident about it with other people. That seems to miss the point. He certainly didn't expect his followers to think of him as the third member of the Trinity. So how could I expect people?
Yeah, he didn't mention
that. First, that people, yeah.
So can you flesh out a little what you mean by mystical view? You'd like people to have a mystical view of the universe?
Yeah.
I think you said a relationship with God. Well, can you flesh out either or both of those?
Yeah, you know, obviously mysticism is a big, huge thing. Generally, I have this assumption that that the way we perceive other people and or the land or creation or even the structures that we built are generally wrong. I think we've been usually enculturated to buy into a bunch of myths. And to me, at least at the very least, mysticism is about a direct experience of a thing. So beginning to have a relationship that's unmediated with like the land, where you start seeing the land for what it is rather than thinking of it as the land underneath my feet as being named Minneapolis. And then being able to be in a relationship with someone where you're just fully attentive to them and seeing them, or even with experience with God, to me, contemplation, even if you experience an emptiness when you're sitting silently, to me, I still see that as an encounter with God. So at the basic level, I think of those as mystical practices, just trying to always give more attention to what's real. And things like money aren't as real as a rock, for example. But I think beyond that, I mean, part of the mystical tradition is that you end up feeling such a union with nature or the person with God that your own sense of your own identity gets fuzzy, and where you end and the other thing begins starts reshaping your whole experience of the world. That's kind of the mystical tradition, this sort of thing. And you can't really ever make that happen for someone. Mm-hmm. But I feel like in my experience, if you're engaging in enough of these attentive practices, sometimes you find yourself in this sort of boundless place. Mm-hmm. And so that's also mystical. That's kind of further up the ladder of mysticism.
Okay. So so your view is, I mean, I don't want to put undiplomatic words in your mouth, but your view is that a large majority of Christians are confused about Jesus' message.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say a strong majority. And I know that sounds arrogant. People accuse me of being arrogant all the time, but I'm like, you know, I'm not making stuff up. Jesus is pretty straightforward. And the fact that we've been so remarkably adept at twisting his words to justify, like, droning Yemeni children, like, that's there's nothing remotely about what Jesus says that somehow condones the vast majority of American activities in the world. So the fact that we think that Trump moves us closer towards Jesus is idolatrous and just incredibly stupid. And so for Christians to buy into that level of thinking, I'm like, wow, this is a tragedy. Mm-hmm. And it makes me angry and makes me think, you know, I claim bullshit on this idea that Christians have to be in unity in some vague sense where we can't call each other out. I'm working on an article and I'm trying to find some sort of relatively mainstream Christian publication to publish this, which is probably a long shot. I think the sort of tactics that Black Lives Matter uses to shut down streets, that Christians that realize how central this perverse version of Christianity has been used to legitimize war and exploitation, we need to start taking those actions and shutting down churches that contribute to this shit.
Whoa, that's intense, man.
No, so we need to me, this is the mythologies of America that are really destructive are coming from somewhere. And largely they're coming from the local church that gives theological justification for this. And we need to go to the heart of the mythology and start disrupting it.
So you want to actually block entrance to churches on Sunday mornings and stuff?
If I could get 1,000 people to do that, or go to like one of these mega churches and just march in and just start singing some sort of cleverly worded subversive hymn just to shut it down, I think that'd be interesting and well worth our time.
It would definitely be interesting.
And to me, if you want to be all traditional about the prophetic ministry, I mean, it's you call out the people that are you're expecting to be faithful first. I mean, Jesus was much stronger in condemning the Pharisees than he was even the Roman government, which I don't really like that fact, but it's because the Pharisees were the people that were supposed to agree with him. So there is this tradition of, like, you go to the people who are most poignant in their hypocrisy first.
But don't you think that tactics like that tend to arouse never-ending opposition to you among precisely the people you're trying to convert?
No, this is the thing. Like with a lot of these tactics, like Black Lives Matter, you know, there's always a lot of people say, "Well, you're hurting your own message." I think there's actually a good reason, especially even now, even though this doesn't seem intuitive to a lot of folks, to encourage more polarization. Okay, so the reason that Trump came to power at the same time that you have a strong resurgence of the left in the United States, and that's not an accident. I feel like the goal seems to be right now to try to bleed out the middle. Like the people that are non-committed middle have to get to a point where they realize what's happening and pick a side. And then the strong, mobilized side of the spectrum should assert its voice.
Because which you're hoping will be yours.
Yeah, or at least it's already happening on the right, and it's not doing anybody any favors to stay in the conciliatory middle, because that is not what moves politics forward. You had a minority of far right-wing people seize the government because they're more activated. So the goal should be to activate more people rather than try to calm everyone towards the middle. I mean, that's not ever really how politics are decided. And since right. The church is this last bastion of right-wing and also the safe middle, I think we need to challenge and poke it, because I think more people are going to be on the side of justice. I mean, this is maybe my naive hopefulness for humanity, than they are on the side of xenophobia and hate.
Right. Although, I mean, one way to look at it is like some of the voters who, in theory, you might think should be supporting a left-wing candidate, you know, people in the Rust Belt, the economy hasn't served them well. And there are people who, like, they would have voted for Bernie, but wouldn't have voted for Hillary, right? I'm thinking about, like, some of those kinds of people, but I'm more thinking about the kind of people who might not have voted for Bernie, but in any event, in theory, they are your people in the sense that they don't have a ton of money and they have not been well served by the existing structure, but they identify with Trump enough that when you, if you show contempt for Trump, I mean, this is an issue that I think is a delicate one. A big issue with some of these people is that I think they're held in contempt by people like me, maybe not by you, I don't know, but like I live on the East Coast and you know, so they think they are, they're held in contempt. And so if you show contempt for Trump, who in my view deserves it, you can sometimes reinforce their allegiance to him, right? I think this is part of the subtlety of this whole thing. Does that make sense?
No, it's true. I mean, there is a delicate thing. Like, I feel like one of the great things about that was effective. I mean, it's easy to move for a lot of us to move past Bernie Sanders and not recognize the brilliance of what happened there. He was effective at mobilizing a group of people who had been largely immobilized, and kind of bring the first time, at least in my life, I've seen something even close to the renewal of the left. Because, you know, I grew up in the Clinton era, the New Democrats, and this was the move to the middle. So all of a sudden, out of nowhere, this old man, he wasn't a young millennial handsome man, he was this old man, started talking about this stuff and it started activating it. And the problem is, it was the right has been much more adept at activating the disgruntled people. And so I'm not talking about, I don't think it's important to get people to hate on Trump. I just think we need to go and activate people around what they're really upset with. Mm-hmm. And I think most people, even in churches, are upset with things like, they're upset with xenophobia. Once they understand it, they're upset with, even in evangelical churches, how some of the hate mongering around gays, I mean, that shift has happened. And maybe some of the old people are still, by and large, conservative in their values, but the young aren't. And right now what we're doing is allowing the young people just to bleed away from the church and allow the old generation, like 1 in 7 pastors in the United States is 40 or under. Like it's an old institution, but there's still this potential of a lot of people waiting to be activated. And what happened is Donald Trump did better at activating the disgruntled rural working class voters than Hillary Clinton did. Mm-hmm. Probably not better than Bernie Sanders did, but Bernie Sanders didn't get to be the nomination. It is polarizing intentionally is a little dangerous, but I think we have to think about it and stop avoiding polarizing and keep doing this thing where we play to the middle. That doesn't work.
Okay. Final question to get back to religion. Yeah. So your view is, it's pretty clear what Jesus said. Blessed are the peacemakers. Meek shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the poor. Although one book says poor, one book says the poor in spirit, whatever. But there are, you know, I assume you're familiar with the counter arguments. I mean, first of all, some people seem to go to great lengths to interpret that verse about the camel and the needle metaphorically. Yeah. Beyond that, though, there's these things where Jesus says, isn't there one where he says, "Think not that I came to bring peace; I came to bring the sword," or something? And there's, and then on the Shirley, well, there's a, I guess, an ambiguous or diversely interpreted verse about "render unto Caesar what is Caesar's," which is sometimes taken to mean, "Look, it's the government." You know, so on. So what is your reaction to, you know, to responses to your view that are not entirely without ammunition, right? I mean, there are these verses that seem at odds with other things Jesus said.
Sure. I mean, it'd be one thing if people were like, you know, generally I agree. Jesus seems to have this at least pacifistic stance, but I have some problem with these verses and need to think it through. That's not what's happening. They're taking the little... these relatively few verses and trying to build a whole, trying to justify their views on it in ways that are like, it's not that they're saying, well, Jesus says blessed are the poor, but there's these other verses about render to Caesar. No, they're saying, no, I want to justify Caesar wholesale, so I'm going to take this one verse and try to use it to build a whole theological structure. That's, to me, a little bit of bullshit. But, you know, the sword, a lot of it also is about not, people don't like to read their Bibles and understand what it's saying. They like to quote verses and use them like ammo. The sword passage is talking about dividing families. It's not talking about killing people. The render to Caesar under Caesar's. That was one of my favorite, this is maybe simplistic, but Dorothy Day says, once you render to God everything that belongs to God, there's nothing left for Caesar, which is kind of true. Like, that's, you know, that's would have been how they would have seen that. Jesus isn't saying, hey, you should all be law-abiding taxpayers with the stuff that Caesar's. And then there's this entirely separate realm from politics that we call faith, where you have to do your devotion. That's not even, there's no way to even argue that Jesus had such a bifurcated view of one's duties in the world. And to me, everything tends to fall away with that. The only really challenging passage, I think, to Jesus's pacifism is where he tells his disciples to take a sword with them. I mean, and then so that they could fulfill the prophecy that they will be considered, so they'll be considered as criminals. To me, that raises some questions. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to be honest about that. I generally tend to think that there's some other stuff going on there that's not exactly obvious. But, I mean, if people want to build a case, then they should build it with that one. The problem is that's a hard case to make. It still takes nuance, and fundamentalists who hate pacifist Jesus don't like nuance.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you, Mark Van Steenwyk. Your book is That Holy Anarchist, Reflections on Christianity and Anarchism. People can buy it at Amazon or download it. They do not have to worry about infringing on its copyright, which does not, in fact, exist, in keeping with your overall philosophy. Any other websites? Is JesusRadicals.com, are you associated with that?
I'm not formally associated with them anymore, but I still support stuff when I can. So they're a great place to go if you're looking at the intersection of Christianity and anarchism. You can also check out the Center for Prophetic Imagination's website, which is at propheticimagination.org.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you for taking the time.
Yeah, it was good talking, Bob.
Same here. Take care.